I'm really looking forward to that 24-hour prayer vigil. That's a really important time. Every single family in the church is going to be prayed for during that particular time, and we'll be receiving prayer requests, all kinds of things. But it is amazing how God takes a season like that, just a day set aside. And when, you know, the scriptures say, if my people will humble themselves and pray and seek my face, God shows up. So just want to encourage you on that. You might think, well, would it really make that much difference? It really does. And in the lives of people, it'll be extraordinary. So I want to ask you to turn to Isaiah 53 one more time. You can see in your study guide that we've taken a portion of the study of Isaiah 53 and moved it over. We ran out of time on the work we've been doing with that. And I don't want to lose this last little section from chapter 53 before we move into chapter 54 today. And we'll unpack both. This last section in chapter 53 is about the outcome of the servant's offering of himself for the sins of the people. Remember, this is God's self-substitution. God offers himself. He is the sacrifice that he commands. And so in the mystery of the Holy Trinity, God the Son offers himself up for the sins of his people. And this is called a guilt offering. He renders himself a guilt offering in verse 10. So what is the outcome of the sacrifice that he makes? So I'm going to pick it up here in the middle of verse 10, after his guilt offering. He will see his offspring, he will prolong his days, and the good pleasure of Yahweh will prosper in his hand as a result of the anguish of his soul. He will see it and be satisfied. Or, just literally, he will see it satisfied. By his knowledge, the righteous one, my servant, will justify the many, as he will bear their iniquities. Therefore, I, that's Yahweh speaking now, will allot him a portion with the great. He will divide the booty with the strong. Because he poured out himself to death and was numbered with the transgressors, yet he himself bore the sin of many and interceded for the transgressors. All right, so a few things to note here in terms of the outcome of the offering up of the servant. First of all, he will see his offspring. He will see the fruit of that labor. In Hebrews chapter 12, it says that Jesus despised the shame and sat down at the right hand of the majesty on high because of the joy that was set before him, who for the joy set before him endured the cross, despised the shame, and sat down at the right hand of the majesty on high. And he did this earlier, it says in Hebrews 2, to bring many sons to glory. So when Christ is on the cross, when this guilt offering is being made, he has in view his people, his children. And this is an important note for us because we sometimes, I think many people perceive Jesus' offering of himself on the cross as a kind of general offering, a kind of, if you will, blanket coverage, rather than something which is very specifically directed towards his children, towards his people. So this note indicates that Christ will see the fruit of that labor on the cross, very specifically, his children. To all those who believe on his name, John 1:12, he gives the right to become the children of God. And in Romans chapter 8, Paul says, we are no longer slaves, but sons and heirs of God through Jesus Christ. So rather than thinking of the cross and the offering of Jesus on the cross as some kind of general thing which is done, it is actually very specific. It is a very specific atonement that is offered. When you hear Jesus say, this is my body broken for, how's it end? You. This is my blood shed for you. Then you hear those words in a deeply personal way. This is not a place where it has in view something which is wide, but something rather which is very deeply specific, very deeply personal. This is the offering for you. He will see his children. So I want you to bear that in mind, that as Christ offers himself, he, think of it like this, has you as his child in view. You are the joy set before him. You are his inheritance. The scriptures speak of God's people being his inheritance. Now, some of you may be waiting for an inheritance. Some of you may have already received an inheritance. Some of you may not have and wished you had. But when we think about an inheritance which is coming, we tend to think of something deeply valuable, of course, something very precious, something which is handed on to the next generation, something which people have cherished and worked hard and treasured, worked hard for and treasured in their lives, and then they pass it to the next generation. You are Jesus' inheritance. You have been given by the Father to the Son. You are the reward of his labor. You are his inheritance. And I have to say that with regard at least to myself, I wouldn't say this about anybody else in the room, it would seem to me that the Lord kind of got a raw deal. Here's your inheritance, it's David. Oh, great. But, of course, that's not the way he looks at it at all, is it? And so he receives us as the reward of his labor. All right, so the next thing he talks about is the prolonging of days, or the continuation of life. In other words, the death that he suffers as the offering, and so it's just hinted at here, is not the end of his existence. In all other sacrifices which are made, the death marks the end of life, of course. Somehow, in this offering, and there's just a hint here of something deeper, something more profound, there is a prolonging of days. What that fully means is not unpacked for us here. But there is somehow, in the offering up of himself, not a final end to who he is. Because the good pleasure of the Lord, or the will of the Lord, will be in his hand. So in other words, somehow, while being the offering who dies, he continues and the will of Yahweh is put in his hands to carry out. So entrusted to the servant is the will of the Father to carry out in the world. So by his death, he redeems personally and individually his people. And even though he has died, somehow his life will continue. Exactly what that means, Isaiah doesn't say at that point. And then the Father entrusts his will, his decree to him to carry out into the world. Now, the way in which the apostles unpacked that was in reference to Isaiah 53 is by using Psalm 2. As well. So I want us to turn over there for just a moment in Psalms. So a very important psalm. It was an enthronement psalm, a coronation psalm, if you will, about God's anointed king on Mount Zion. Now let's remember, he offers his life, and that pays for the sins of the people, but his days continue. He has an extension of life in some way, and entrusted to him is the will of the Father. Why are the nations in an uproar and the peoples devising a vain thing? The kings of the earth take their stand, and the rulers take counsel together against the Lord and against his Christ, or his anointed, saying, let us tear their fetters apart and cast away their cords from us. So that's the world in reference to the Lord and his Christ. They don't want him to rule. The response of God to the nations, the Gentiles, saying we want nothing to do with the kingdom of God is this: he who sits in the heavens laughs. The Lord scoffs at them. Then he will speak to them in his anger and terrify them in his fury, saying, as for me, I have installed my king on Zion, my holy mountain. Then the voice changes to the king, who is called the Son. I will surely tell of the decree of the Lord. He said to me, you are my son. Today I have begotten you. Ask of me, and I will surely give the nations as your inheritance and the ends of the earth as your possession. So here, what happens in Psalm 2 is a reversal. In Psalm 2, it begins with the nation saying, we want nothing to do with Christ. And then the son says, yes, but here's the truth. I've been enthroned as king in Zion, and I'm going to tell you what the Father said to me. He said to me, you're my son. Now notice the phrase, today I have begotten you. All right, today I have begotten you. Ask of me, and I will surely give you the what? The nation. So these very people who are today opposed to you are going to become your inheritance. The ends of the earth will become your possession. So that's a very important verse for us in a number of ways. First of all, let's just notice that the very people who are the most virulent opponents of the Messiah become, by the mystery of grace, his inheritance. God says, I'm going to give you as an inheritance, he says to the son, the very people who today are your opponents, who want nothing to do with you. I'm going to sow. How does that work? Well, it's all tied up in that phrase, today I have begotten you. Now, the way the apostles interpreted that and the way this inheritance works is that they interpreted that phrase, today I have begotten you, as the resurrection. Now, if you come over to Acts 13, let's go over there, because it's important for us to pick up on what this phrase means. Because when you read a phrase like, today I have begotten you, we think, well, does that mean like on the day that Mary gave birth to him or he was conceived in the womb? What is that really in reference to? Well, let's look how Paul quotes this. In Acts 13, let's pick it up in verse 28. Though they found no ground for putting him to death, they asked Pilate that he be executed. And when they had carried out all that was written concerning him, they took him down from the cross and laid him in a tomb. But God raised him from the dead. And for many days he appeared to those who came up with him from Galilee to Jerusalem, the very ones who are now witnesses to the people. And we preach to you the good news of the promise made to the fathers, that God has fulfilled this promise to our children in that he raised up Jesus. As it is written in the second Psalm, why don't you say it with me? You are my son. Today I have begotten you. And as for the fact that he raised him from the dead, no longer to return to decay, he has spoken in this way, I will surely give you the holy and sure blessings of David. That's Isaiah 55. We'll get there. And therefore, he also says in another psalm, you will not allow your Holy One to undergo decay. That's Psalm 16. David, after he served the purpose of God in his own generation, fell asleep and was laid among his fathers and underwent decay. But he whom God raised did not undergo decay. So now it's very interesting. The apostles took Psalm 2, today I have begotten you, as a reference to Jesus being raised from the dead. So the way they picture it is this, the tomb is a womb from which Jesus emerges, and here's the language Paul uses in Colossians. You'll remember this phrase, the firstborn of the dead. The firstborn of the dead. And this is how Christ raised from the dead, then, not to undergo decay, right? Now he's the new David reigning on Mount Zion. He doesn't go out to conquer the nations with a sword that's military in nature. He goes out to conquer the nations with a sword that is spiritual in nature. The sword of the Spirit. The gospel, the word of the Lord. So the nations become his inheritance and the ends of the earth his possession. So when you read Psalm 2, you're seeing the way in which God says, this is my king on Zion will inherit the nations of the world. And this is the reward that he receives because he offers himself up as an offering. I'm going to entrust my will to him. I will surely tell, remember Psalm 2? I will surely tell of the decree of the Lord. He said, you are my son, today I've begotten you. Ask of me, and I will give you the nations as your inheritance and the ends of the earth as your possession. I want you to understand today that no matter how troubled or how full of doubt or how much collapse you see of the church or the gospel in various places, the end is certain and secure. All the nations of the world will come and worship at the footstool of Jesus. This is what Scripture proclaims. All the nations will come and worship before him. And this is the will of God, and he has promised the Son that he will carry it out, and he has entrusted it to the hands of his Son. He's placed it in his hands. He will see his offspring. He will prolong his days. He will cause his will, his good pleasure, to prosper in his hand. All right, well, let's come back to Isaiah 53. That's Isaiah 53:10. Now, in Isaiah 53:11, as a result of the anguish of his soul, satisfaction is accomplished. That's that issue of God's justice. The righteous one, my servant, will justify the many as he will bear their iniquities. Notice the connection between justification and sin bearing. Because he bears sin, because he takes it upon himself, he therefore can turn to those whose sin he has borne and declare them what? Justified. Remember Romans chapter 3? Because of the blood offering that he makes, God is both just and the justifier of the one who has faith in Jesus. He will bear their iniquities. So justification, that word is translated as righteousness as well. Justification with God, right standing with God, is not based on anything we have done. It is based exclusively. You have to build a big fence around this. It is based exclusively on what Jesus has done on the cross. By the offering, the anguish of his soul. Imagine for a moment standing at the foot of the cross and you see, in the words of Isaiah, the anguish of his soul. You see not only the physical suffering, but suppose for just a moment that God could pull back the curtain and allow you to see the anguish of his soul. And seeing that, you then say to Jesus, this is really good, but I want to add to it my contribution so that I will be acceptable before God. Can you imagine? Well, you would never, ever say that. You would see the anguish of his soul, and you would say, all you could do is bow with grateful worship, right? That's all. You could just be bewildered by with amazement at that moment that you saw what he did for you, and you would never dream of adding to it. And yet, every day, that's our temptation. We think if we can just be a little better, we will be in better standing with God. But my friends, your standing with God, your justification, is grounded solely in the sacrifice of Jesus, from which nothing can be taken away, and to which nothing can be added. It is perfect. And because of that, you and I can have peace with God. Romans chapter 5, therefore, having been justified by his blood, we have peace, shalom, with God. It is never based in our performance, ever. It is based in his offering. Settle that in your soul. Settle that in your soul. I am right with God today, not because of anything I have done or could ever do. I am right with God today because of everything that Jesus has done, and it's perfect. And he did it for me. He will see his offspring. He saw you. His work on the cross was for you, personally. Once you say, the work of Jesus on the cross is for me, and that work is perfect, then you can spend the rest of your life giving thanks. Because you know that you're God's own child. What a beautiful passage. Well, what's the end for the servant? Verse 12. I will allot him a portion with the great. So remember, if you go back into chapter 52, where this whole servant song begins, it says that kings would be astonished because this one who was marred, his appearance was marred. Kings will shut their mouths on account of him. I want you to notice here that it says that he will be allotted a portion with the great. So this one who is deeply humiliated, this one who is marred, this one who is given over to death, the one who is numbered with the transgressors, who pours himself out. That's sacrifice language in verse 12. This one who bears the sin of many is going to be given a portion with the great. He will no longer be despised. He will now be exalted. And the result of this is, and the reason that's the result is because he interceded for the transgressors. So the Father promises him, rather than remaining in a position of subjugation and remaining in a place of humiliation, he is exalted. He is exalted. So now, rather than being someone from whom men hide their faces, now he has a portion with the great. So we move from humiliation to exaltation. And that's exactly how Paul characterizes this in one of the great hymns of the ancient church, which is Philippians 2, 5 through 11. Have this mind in yourselves, which was also in Christ Jesus, who, although he existed in the form of God, did not regard equality with God as something to be grasped, but he emptied himself, right? He humbled himself, and being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became a servant unto death, even death what? On the cross. Therefore, everybody say therefore. Therefore, God has highly exalted him and given him or bestowed on him the name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee must bow and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. So the end of the servant is exaltation. And that's exactly the way that the apostles treat that. And they quote, again, when Paul's quoting that, he's quoting from Isaiah 45, And then he does, again, from Isaiah 52, he's quoting that over in Romans 15, 22. Those who've had no news of him shall see, and those who have not heard shall understand. So the end of the passage on the suffering of the servant is the exaltation of the servant and the nations of the world being given to him as his inheritance. Now, that is celebrated and was celebrated in a song that Israel had sung for many, many years and which we know today. It's Psalm 22. Let's look over at that real briefly here this morning. Psalm 22. Now, Psalm 22 is well known, some of the words are well known, as the Psalm of the Cross. You'll notice this from the very first words of the song. My God, why hast thou forsaken me? Far from my deliverance are the words of my groaning. Oh, my God, I cry by day, but you do not answer, and by night, and I have no rest. Yet you are holy, O you who are enthroned upon the praises of Israel. So, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? These words are uttered by Jesus on the cross. Lord, where are you? I'm in agony. Look at verse 7. All who see me sneer at me. They mock me. They wag their heads, saying, trust yourself to the Lord. Let him deliver him. Let him rescue him because he delights in him. Well, those are words which are nearly exactly quoted at the foot of the cross by people mocking Jesus. He saved others, but himself he could not save. If God delights in you, he'll bring you down from the cross. Verse 9, yet you are he who brought me forth from the womb. You made me trust when upon my mother's breasts. Upon you I was cast from birth. You've been my God from my mother's womb. Be not far from me. Trouble is near. I'm poured out, this is verse 14, I'm poured out like water. My bones are out of joint. My heart melts like wax. It is melted within me. Verse 16, the dogs surround me. A band of evildoers encompass me. They pierce my hands and my feet. They divide, verse 18, they divide my garments among them. And for my clothing, they cast lots. All right. You go, okay, right, I know these words. This is this Psalm of the Cross. I know this. All right, so here's the suffering of God's anointed. But where's it end? Where's it end? Verse 22. I will tell of your name to my brethren. In the midst of the assembly, I will praise you. Now, that's quoted over in Hebrews 2 about Jesus calling us his brethren. Jesus leading us in worship. I've preached on that text. Jesus is the worship leader. Those words are from the cross. This is from the midst of suffering. Jesus says, I'm going to call you my brothers and my sisters, and I'm going to lead in worship. Verse 25, from you comes my praise in the great assembly. Verse 27, what's the end of his suffering? All the ends of the earth will remember and turn to the Lord, and all the families of the nations will worship before you, for the kingdom is the Lord's, and he rules over the nations. What starts out with, my God, why hast thou forsaken me, ends with worship and praise in the congregation and the ends of the earth coming into the kingdom. That's critical for our understanding, especially just now as we enter into just a couple of weeks off now from Holy Week, and we come to Good Friday, and we come face to face again, as we must be reminded to do, with the agony of Jesus, the anguish of his soul. Is that where it stops? Is that the end? Why were the dogs all around him? Well, the dogs were there because the dogs were there. They didn't bury crucified people when they died. They just tossed them to the dogs. That's why it was called the place of, it's Golgotha, the place of the skull. It was just bones everywhere because the dogs ate the bodies. They were cursed. They weren't buried, but Jesus was buried and then raised and then exalted, and the ends of the earth all the families of the earth, all the nations, which goes back to that promise to Abraham, they all come and worship before him. So the end of the suffering of the servant is the exaltation of the servant and the conversion of the world. That's what's in view in Isaiah. Now, when you know that, then when you turn to the next section of Isaiah, what you encounter makes perfect sense. Because this next section of Isaiah, and you can turn back over there now, Isaiah 54, Isaiah 54 is a transitional chapter which takes us into the final section of Isaiah, 55 through 66, which is a kind of eschatological section. Now, eschatology is a big word about how the future that God has planned has invaded the present in Jesus. And what Isaiah does is he stands, remember how Isaiah does this, he stands in the middle of history, he stands in the middle of it, and he looks back at what God has done, and standing where he is, he announces what God's intentions are, pointing forward to what God is going to do. Now, if you remember that the suffering of the servant is for the healing of Israel and the conversion of the nations, and he's exalted, and God has put his will in his hands, and all the nations are coming to him, then if you know that, then you begin to see how Isaiah 54 and the following chapters will be fulfilled. And the way in which it is used is the language of the bride. It's bridal theology. And it's beautiful. After this terrible suffering, after this ordeal and this anguish, comes the wedding. Shout for joy, O barren one, you who have borne no child. Break forth into joyful shouting and cry aloud, you who have not travailed. For the sons of the desolate one will be more numerous than the sons of the married woman, says the Lord. Enlarge the place of your tent. Stretch out the curtains of your dwelling. Spare not. Lengthen your cords. Strengthen your pegs. You will spread abroad to the right and to the left, and your descendants will possess nations and resettle the desolate cities. Remember, Isaiah says they're going to be carried into captivity. Judgment's coming. Those cities are going to be desolate. But the day is coming when out of barrenness will come fruitfulness. Now, who's the ultimate archetype in Israel's history of the barren woman who miraculously becomes fruitful? Well, that's Sarah, right? And back in Isaiah 51, look to the rock from which you were hewn, to the quarry from which you were dug. Look to Abraham and to Sarah who gave birth to you in pain. In other words, it was a miraculous work that God did in Abraham and Sarah, and he's going to do something again that is equally miraculous. Though Israel is devastated and desolate, God is going to, out of its barrenness, create a new fruitfulness. A barren woman is going to cry aloud and give birth. So the barren one becomes fruitful. We'll come back to that in just a moment. Here's the next section. The wife who is deserted because of her infidelity will be recovered and restored. Verses 4 through 8. Fear not. You will not be put to shame. Do not feel humiliated. You will not be disgraced. You will forget the shame of your youth and the reproach of your widowhood. You will remember no more. For your husband is your maker, whose name is the Lord of hosts, and your Redeemer is the Holy One of Israel, who is called the God of all the earth. The Lord has called you like a wife forsaken and grieved in spirit, even like a wife of one's youth when she is rejected, says your God. For a brief moment, I forsook you, but with great compassion, I will gather you. In an outburst of anger, I hid my face from you for a moment, but with everlasting loving kindness, I will have compassion on you, says the Lord your Redeemer. So here God compares his people to a bride which has been disgraced. And in his anger, God says, that's it. But then he says, that was a brief moment, but I have something of everlasting loving kindness. And I'm going to bring you back. This is picked up, by the way, this theme is picked up by a contemporary of Isaiah called Hosea. And if you ever read Hosea, Hosea is a prophet who's given a charge by God to go and marry a prostitute. Well, that's bad enough, isn't it? You know, the Lord says, go marry this prostitute, but it gets her name was Gomer. Go marry, I mean, if the Lord tells you to go marry Gomer, that's a hard call right there, don't you think? And she keeps running off. She keeps running off. She keeps going back. And what does Hosea do? He keeps going, what does he do? He keeps going after her. And he says, this is what I'm like with my people. I keep going after them. I keep coming after them. How are you glad the Lord didn't give up on you? He just keeps coming after it. He just keeps coming. And this is what he says for Israel. I'm going to come back and I'm going to restore you. But this recovery of the people and this birth and fruitfulness that comes out of barrenness is something that's going to have an impact on the whole world. Verses 9 and 10. This is like the days of Noah to me. When I swore that the waters of Noah would not flood the earth again, so I've sworn I will not be angry with you, nor will I rebuke you. The mountains may be removed, the hills may shake, but my loving kindness will not be removed from you, and my covenant of peace will not be shaken, says the Lord who has compassion on you. Isaiah has in view here a new covenant. And he references Noah. You remember what God did after the flood. God said to Noah, that's it, I'll never flood the earth again. There's an end, I'm drawing a line here. And Isaiah says there's a new covenant coming that God is going to make with his people. It's a new covenant. He calls it here the covenant of peace. Jeremiah calls it the new covenant that God makes with his people after the exile. So I want you to see how Jeremiah uses that language. Let's go over there. You have to kind of turn forward a few pages from Isaiah. Pardon me, and go over to Jeremiah 31 and see what happens over here. Jeremiah 31, the very same concept where God is promising restoration for his people. So Jeremiah 31, verse 27, and this language of husband and maker and redeemer, new covenant, all of this is used here in Jeremiah 2. Behold, days are coming, declares the Lord, when I will sow the house of Israel and the house of Judah with the seed of man and the seed of beast. And as I have watched over them to pluck up, to break down, to overthrow, to destroy, and to bring disaster, so I will watch over them to build and to plant, declares the Lord. In those days, they will not say again, the fathers have eaten sour grapes and the children's teeth are set on edge. Everyone will die for his own iniquity. Each man who eats sour grapes, his teeth will be set on edge. Behold, days are coming, declares the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah. Not like the covenant which I made with their fathers in the day when I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt. My covenant which they broke, although I was a husband to them, declares the Lord. This is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, declares the Lord. I will put my law within them, and on their heart I will write it. Now see, when God made the first covenant with Israel, where did he write the law? Tablets of stone. God says, now I'm going to write it on their heart. And I will be their God, and they will be my people, and they will not teach again every man his neighbor and each man his brother, saying, know the Lord. For they will all know me, from the least of them to the greatest of them, declares the Lord, and I will forgive their iniquity and remember their sins no more. That's the promise of the new covenant. That's quoted then over in the New Testament many times, particularly in the book of Hebrews, where it talks about the new arrangement that we have, that God made with us through Jesus Christ. When Jesus then, think about these words in Jeremiah, think about the words in Isaiah, then Jesus, at the Last Supper, he gets to the very end of the Passover meal, and the Last Supper turns into something different. It becomes the Lord's Supper. Where's the transition point from Last Supper to Lord's Supper? It's this. Before picking up the final cup, Jesus picks up bread and he says, this is my body broken for you. And then he picks up the cup And he says, this cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for many for the remission of sins. Drink from it, all of you. In that moment, at that table, Jesus established the new covenant. And he said, by those words, imagine the shock to the disciples. They thought they were coming for just an ordinary Passover meal. And Jesus says to them, the new covenant that Jeremiah talked about, the covenant of peace that Isaiah saw coming, it's happening tonight, right now, right before your eyes. A new covenant. It's not going to be like the old covenant. That was broken. This one will never be broken. And I'm not going to write laws on tablets of stone. I'm going to write them where? On your heart. And you're going to have a personal, each one of you will have a personal relationship with me. You will all know me, from the least to the greatest, from the youngest to the oldest, from the most poor to the mightiest. Everyone will have a personal relationship with God. You will all know me, from the least to the greatest. And I'll forgive your sins, and I will remember your sins, what? No more. That's the moment it happened. And then he goes to the cross, and he becomes the offering. Jeremiah sees that day coming, just as Isaiah did. So here in Isaiah 54, God says, just as the earth was cleansed in the flood of Noah, and just as I promised to never flood the earth again, I'm making you this promise. I'm going to make you my people. Think about this for just a second. Some people say to me at times, you know, can you lose your salvation? I could lose anything. I know people who've lost kids, you know, left them in Walmart, all right? I lose stuff all the time. Where are my keys? The question isn't whether or not you can lose Jesus. The question is whether or not Jesus can lose you. Where did I put Diane, you know? Does that happen? No, God will not lose you. He's established a covenant of peace. This is it. You're my people. This will never be broken. So, back to Isaiah 54. O afflicted one, storm-tossed and not comforted, behold, I will set your stones in antimony, and your foundations I will lay in sapphires. What? What's this about? I will make battlements of rubies and your gates of crystal and your entire wall of precious stones. Wait a minute. This is a city. This is a city that's made of jewels. Where else do we read in the Bible of a city made of jewels? Well, that's the book of Revelation. What have we got here? Well, this is a new Jerusalem. Now, in the book of Revelation, it says, come and I will show you the bride, the wife of the Lamb. And I looked and I saw a great city coming down from heaven, prepared by God as a bride. The city of God, the heavenly Jerusalem, is called the bride of Christ. And that is rooted right here in Isaiah 54. That the people of God become the bride of the Savior through the new covenant, and they become a new city, a new city. All your sons will be literally disciples of the Lord, and great will be the well-being of your children. In righteousness you will be established. You will be far from oppression, and you will not fear. From terror, it will not come near you. If anyone fiercely assails you, it will not be from me. Whoever assails you will fall because of you. Behold, I myself have created the smith who blows the fire of coals and brings out a weapon for its work. I have created the destroyer to ruin. You look at all the judgment, you look at all the devastation which the prophets are saying is coming. Yes, that's all true. You need to understand, I'm sovereign even over those things. I'm the one who gives the weapon maker his fire and his skill. Yes, that's all true. But those days of destruction are coming to an end, because look at verse 17. No weapon that's formed against you will prosper. And every tongue that accuses you in judgment, you will condemn. This is the heritage of the servants of the Lord, and their justification or vindication is from me, declares the Lord. So in this new city that God's preparing, the new Jerusalem that he's preparing, that you and I are part of, that city can no longer be brought into slavery. That city will never again endure exile. In that city, no condemnation can arise. In that city, no accusation against you can stand. Now, here's what I want to know. How many of you are part of the bride of Christ? How many of you are part of the city of God? Well, yes, you are. And so what does that mean? It means that no weapon formed against you will prosper. It means that every single accusation the enemy raises comes to nothing. It means that you can never be forsaken by the Lord. Now, all of this is Isaiah standing in the middle of history, and he's looking back at redemptive history. He's looking at the days of Noah. He's looking at the days of Abraham and Sarah, and he's talking about God and his people entering into a marriage covenant. That, of course, has its roots right there in the book of Genesis, because that is the culmination of God's good work of creation when he brings Eve to Adam, and they're together, and then God calls that the supreme good. This is finally good. It wasn't good for man to be alone, but man and woman together, that's good. It's a manifestation of who God is. All right. But it was also the place where the fall took place. It's also the place where rebellion culminated and brokenness entered in. And so it is with God and his people. But God redeems his people. God sent Adam and Eve out of the garden. They went into exile, but God does not leave them out of the garden. He created a sacrificial system to bring them back into the Holy of Holies, to come back into communion with him, to come back to the garden. And when you get to the book of Revelation and you see the city, which Isaiah begins to talk about, you see the city, what's in the middle of the city? A river. What was flowing through Eden? A river. And what's on either side of the river in the heavenly Jerusalem? A tree of life. And we're invited back to the tree of life, and the leaves of that tree are for the healing of the nations. God is restoring his people, and he's renewing the covenant. And this means that God has betrothed us to himself. We are his bridal people. And Paul picks this up, and he uses this language in 2 Corinthians 11, just as the writer of Revelation does. In 2 Corinthians 11, Paul says, I have betrothed you to one husband, to Christ. And in Ephesians 5, he talks about the church being the bride of Christ, for whom the Savior lays down his life, cleansing us with the washing of the water of his word. So we are betrothed. Now, in Hebrew culture, to be betrothed meant that you were promised. The wedding had not yet happened. So when you get to the book of Revelation, the wedding happens at the end. Revelation 19:6, blessed are those who are invited to the marriage supper of the Lamb. Right? The bride, hallelujah, rejoice and be glad, the bride has made herself ready. So there's this period of preparation, betrothal, and then the wedding itself. You remember, Mary is what to Joseph? Betrothed. She's betrothed. Now, they haven't yet been married. They're in that promissory period where, and here's the way this worked in Hebrew culture. In Hebrew culture, the man had the responsibility to go and prepare a house for this new family. And the bride was to make herself ready. He's getting ready a house. She's preparing herself. So the bride makes herself ready. He gets the house ready. When the house is fully ready and the bride is fully ready, then the best man, called the friend of the bridegroom, comes into the village, and of course the whole village is gathered. Everybody knows this is going to happen. And the friend of the bridegroom announces, the bridegroom cometh. And the bridegroom goes to the house of the betrothed. He goes to her house. And when he gets to her house, she is seated. And when he walks in, she rises to meet him and goes with him to his house. That's the marriage. Now listen, John 14. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go, I will come again and receive you to myself. That's bridal language. He's getting the house ready. He'll be back when it's done. And he'll be back when the bride is ready. Hallelujah. Let us rejoice and be glad, for the marriage of the Lamb has come, because the bride has what? Made herself ready. She's gotten ready. And when that day happens, it says, this is the way it goes. The Lord himself shall descend from heaven with what? Shout, the voice of the archangel and the trumpet of God. And the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we who are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them. And thus we shall meet the Lord in the air, and thus we shall always be with the Lord. So he comes to our house. And when he comes, what's the bride doing? She's seated, and what does she do when he comes? She rises. That's bridal language in 1 Thessalonians 4. We will rise, we will meet him, and we will go to his house. Beautiful. And you go, this is our destiny. And this is what Isaiah is talking about. And this is what the apostles were on about. That God is remaking everything in terms of a new covenant, and he will never let us go. And you are his bride, and you're beautiful, and you're precious to him. Amen. So the rest of Isaiah 55 through 66 unpacks the way that looks. The promise of God for new heavens and new earth. Not making all new things, but all things new. And we'll dive into that over the next couple of weeks and see how this, the eschatology of Isaiah, reshapes our imagination about how we live right now in this world as the people of God and the city of God. Amen? It's a beautiful passage, my friends. All right, well, let's stop there, and we've got a few minutes for comments or questions. Let me pray for us. Lord, I thank you for the promise that you have made that we should be the bride of the Son. And this we are, not because of anything we have done, but because of everything he has done. Thank you that through the apostles we are betrothed to him, and he is making all things ready. And we pray that you would help us to respond to his loving grace and the washing of the water of his word in our lives, that more and more we might be clothed in bright and sparkling garments, and we thank you for this. Thank you, Lord, that you never stopped pursuing us, and that you will never break your covenant with us, that you will keep it eternally and in everlasting loving kindness. And we praise you for this. Amen. All right. Well, there we go. Just general comments or questions or anything on that. There's a lot to cover there, I know. But Isaiah 54 is a lovely passage there. And there's some things in your notes. You can look up back in Genesis on the subject of barrenness and so on. Anyone? Comments, questions? Yeah, Star. It's a daily devotional guide. I hope it's you will like it. That's what Star said. You will like it. Yeah. Doug? Yeah. Okay. I don't know that I've ever heard anybody say that. I've heard them say things like wrong imaginations, you know, that kind of thing. Yeah, but I've heard people say that kind of thing. You know, You know, Paul talks about taking every thought captive to the obedience of Christ over in, I think, 2 Corinthians 10, casting down vain imaginations. I mean, there's that kind of thing. But here's the deal. One of the things that we forget is that the Bible is a giant pop-up picture book. And I talked about that in the John study a little bit. This was an oracular culture more than it was a literary culture. So there was a class of people who were trained to read, but most people didn't read. And I'm talking about specifically the people of Israel, Old Testament people. So they didn't sit down with a scroll and just read it. That was really a very elite group of people, trained priests and so on, royal household. But most people, everyday people, would not necessarily have been literate. And they wouldn't have had access to books. And so the way in which God's people have more often than not encountered Scripture is by having it read to them, right? You take the scroll and you read it. Everybody didn't have their own private scroll. Like today we can go to a bookstore and we can buy 47 different versions of an English Bible, right? You know, but that's, so we just live in a different age. But they had to listen. And by listening, that inevitably produces what? Pictures, images. So Paul talks about in Galatians, he says, how can you forsake Christ before whose eyes he was publicly portrayed as crucified? It's an interesting passage. It's a word it's the same word we get our English word portrait from. In other words, Paul, by his words, because the Galatians didn't see Jesus crucified, he says Christ was portrayed as crucified. So Paul, by his words, painted pictures. That's what good preachers will do. They'll paint pictures. And so he painted the picture of Jesus suffering for them, and he said, how can you, having seen that, turned away from it, you see? So I think, actually, the greater problem for contemporary Christians that I know is an impoverishment of their imagination. I think we need a more robust imagination, one that is purged of false idols, idols of sexuality, idols of power, idols of greed, symbols of envy, and so on. And instead, we take on board the images of like the book of Revelation. The book of Revelation is an image book. It's all about having images. I looked and I saw. I looked and I saw. I looked and I saw. It's repeated over and over again. And the whole point was written to these Christians who were living in Asia Minor. And so they're surrounded by images of Roman power and idolatry, the Temple of Diana in Ephesus and so on. And so if you're surrounded by that, you can feel deeply oppressed by it and think, well, you know, where's the Lord? But the book of Revelation says, let me show you what's really going on. So they begin to fill their minds and their imagination, if you will, with the truth of a cosmology which belongs to the gospel. And I think actually what we've got a problem with today isn't too much imagination. In a way, it's too little. And I think that's why imagination is such a powerful thing that God's given us. If we think about it, imagination is something that God's given us. So it has a deep appeal to us. It's why we love all of our fairy stories. It's why we dig Harry Potter and others. And if you read all the fairy stories, it's important to remember that they're all in some ways reflections of the ultimate narrative. It's why there will come a prince who gives us a kiss and raises us from the dead. At the end of history, all the fairy stories do come true. Yeah.
If you look at Hebrews 11, verse 1, it says, faith is the evidence of things hoped for. But it's hoped for, it's not something we see.
Yeah, it's not seen yet.
It points to the future. It's the conviction of things not seen. And that is so powerful. So I can tell a child, it's 75 degrees outside, and that's a fact, and it's true. And I can also say, close your eyes and imagine the sun shining on your face. Can you feel how warm it is?
Mm-hmm.
And that's an act of imagination. And it enhances the truth. Because somehow it goes from just a fact that you know to a fact
Yeah, you experience it. And what you're describing is, Diane, is that's the way Scripture actually works. It doesn't work like a manual on how to put together an air conditioner. Right. But we try to do that to it. We try to turn it into an instruction manual instead of it being something which is a part of the prophetic imagination.
Right, and that, and to add to that, I heard one of our women's retreat speakers told us years ago, we often read the Bible just for information.
Right.
We need to read the Bible for relationship.
For relationship.
And then when you do, you open with the language of inheritance, that
yeah.
Fear God's inheritance in John 6. And I'd always known that, well, since I've been a believer, and I used it to defend, you know, all kinds of things that were given to Christ as, you know, in Reformed theology. But when I read that for relationship, I fell apart in tears to think that I could be a gift to Jesus.
You're a gift to Jesus. You go, what? Right.
Take.
Right. That's a mind blower. Yeah, Sandy? We live in a city of really great creators, people who are poets and lyricists, musicians. It's wonderful to be here. And those are people who are really gifted with great imagination. They can see things and hear things, and they help us. We feel things more deeply because of their giftedness. You know, they help us say, I love you, in ways that we wouldn't have thought to say it. Or I'm hurting in ways that I wouldn't have thought to say it. So we're surrounded by those poets, and I think those people, as we've noted about music and the arts in Isaiah, have a certain giftedness of the Holy Spirit happening in them, even if they don't know it. So there is a kind of element running through church history which is deeply cautious about images. It has to be said about images, about turning imagination into images, which we then bow down and worship. That's a different issue. Right, so you could, but having your imagination filled with the thoughts of God's beauty and glory is a good thing, and where Scripture gives us those images, we should run with them, and we shouldn't be afraid of them, if that helps at all. Great question, Doug. Well, we're out of time, except now to move into our groups, and I would encourage you to read Isaiah 55 through 66 over the next couple of weeks, and we'll tackle those. We're going to have a blast together with them. I promise you that. As we come, look at what you've done. You've come all the way to the end of Isaiah. Man. And so, you know, gold medal. And we'll get it wrapped up in the next couple of weeks.